We want to get straight to that remarkable story of the mine rescue in India. There have been jubilant scenes after 41 workers trapped in a tunnel for 17 days were finally brought to safety.
The drawn-out rescue mission gripping viewers right around the world and guided by a hero Melbourne rescuer.
Let's go live to Europe correspondent Ash Mullaney. Well, these men, they've been through an incredible ordeal.
Shovo, Nat, good morning. And these are just incredible pictures too coming out of India tonight. After 2 weeks, more than 2 weeks, trapped underground, these 41 men have been safely rescued, in part thanks to this Melbourne tunnelling expert, Arnold Dix. He made a promise to get these men out by Christmas and he has done that with weeks to spare. It was a delicate rescue, a long, tedious process to get these men out. They were using heavy equipment to start with, and then in the final days they were relying on a team of expert miners to start digging by hand and using small tools. In the end, these men had to crawl out through a 57 metre pipe to come to freedom, and this is what was waiting for them on the other end. Slaps on the back, flowers, scenes of absolute jubilation, and you can only imagine why, having been trapped under there for so long. Thankfully, they had food and water helping to keep them alive. India's Prime Minister has thanked families for their patience and courage, something these miners would have certainly needed while they were stuck underground, and something that would have no doubt tested them mentally as well as physically too. Guys?
Okay, thank you very much, Ash. Now, I think we have Aussie tunnelling expert Arnold Dix on the phone right now. First of all, congratulations. This is an amazing feat. Could you tell us, how did you get the call up for this?
I don't know quite how I got the call, but one way or another, I found myself literally in a helicopter being whisked out like in a MASH movie up into the Himalayas, and was confronted with something I've never seen before, which was a mountain that internally had an avalanche with millions of tons of rock and a huge cavity inside the mountain. And 41 people, the miracle was 41 people on the other side alive. And then it was a huge team of experts, the experts here in India who were just fantastic understanding the Himalayas. But I just had a feeling that we were going to be able to do it. But I've got to say, I had a few calls because I promised, as you say, I landed, had a look, and I promised to the families, I said, 41 men are coming home safe and no one's going to get hurt. But actually, my little inside voice was going, exactly how are we going to do that, Arnold? But we figured it out, and it was really hard, and it was like surgery. We were facing not only the catastrophic failure in the mountain, which would have obviously had the consequences you can imagine on the men, but also on us as the rescue team. So it's been like, hopefully I won't have to do this again. Once in a lifetime, and I've never seen anything like this in my life, doing this sort of work.
Arnold, what a promise, and you absolutely delivered. Just take us through some of the challenges. You say how precarious it was, how difficult it was. What was the hardest thing?
Well, it's knowing that the likelihood is they're all going to die. And so you're starting knowing that everyone's alive, and you know that if you make a wrong move, that changes. And you've got a mountain that's actually, its middle has dropped out and more can come at any moment. And we knew that everything was unstable. So we have advanced systems of measuring what's going on. We could see it's all moving. Like, we could see the rock moving. So just a small, like an earthquake, could have triggered the whole thing and it would be game over. And, you know, our lifelines were only just lifelines. We'd only just got we could just get air into them and food and medicine, but that was it. And we couldn't figure out how to get another line through, and all the machines had blown up, and, you know, and. Like, if you looked at it, you wouldn't be putting a bet on this one. And yet what was amazing is that all of the different agencies came together. So the army, I had a tent in an army camp, you know, like, so I could work through the night. And all the army guys were working with all of the border dudes and the all, anyway, it's just all of us working together. Yeah. And we were all committed all committed that we were going to get them home and we weren't going to hurt anyone in the process. We didn't exactly know how, but we figured that we'd be able to, you know, we'd work it out. And at a time when the whole world is completely, and I want to swear, but like bloody stupid, like totally insane, mucked up, here is a disaster where everyone's actually been nice and we're all working together. And we put away all our political differences, and it doesn't matter what God you're from or into, and it doesn't matter what country you're from, we all help each other. And at a time when, like, I mean, I don't mean to go on and on, but this is just, like, I don't know how we did it myself. And I know how we did it, but we did it. And then we've all just come back. This sounds really odd. We all jumped in our, you know, cars with flashing lights. We just came back, and one of the people had a birthday. So we had a little birthday party. You know, like, it's just amazing.
Oh, gee. Arnold, yeah. It is such a, we can hear the emotion, yeah, in your voice, because you've been through this incredible thing and you've done such an incredible feat, you know, along with all these people. If you're just joining us at nearly 8 minutes past six on this Wednesday morning, we're talking to one of the main rescuers, Melbourne man Arnold Dix, who has achieved this incredible feat, getting these 41 men out of this mine in the middle of India. Tell us, we're seeing the pictures, obviously, of them coming out and the congratulations. We're also just, yeah, seeing these pictures of this big pipe thing going into the mine. Can you just tell us a bit about how you did it in layman's terms?
Yeah, well, you take a million tonnes of avalanche and then you go to Macca's and you get a straw and then you just start pushing it in the general direction.
Really?
And that's... No, well, it's not... Well, obviously, it's not like... What we did, we tried many things and pretty much all of them failed. Okay, so we tried the biggest and toughest machine and basically it blew itself up. We tried a great big auger, which is like a mincer, but it's for rocks, where you stick it in the rocks and it sort of minces them up and it spits them out, and that blew itself up. And in the end, the technique that we kind of agreed on was we'd actually do it by hand, and we'd do it really softly, and we'd do it 100 millimetres at a time, and we'd have men down that pipe with their hands 100 millimetres at a time, and we would creep quietly towards the men, because we knew if we did rattle the ground anymore, it'll all collapse and it'll be all over. So the real heroes of this, they're these guys, I forget the name, I don't even know what it translates to, but it's a team of, I think, five guys who go down into this pipe right up to the end, and they just take out the rocks really, really carefully. And then when they've got them carefully out, we give it a little push, and then we do it again and again and again. And we just, the last 10 metres, it's like we're so close, but it's a little bit like drowning. Your nose only has to be under the water 1 millimetre and you still drown. Well, it's like that. It was absolutely nerve-like. And while this is happening, the roof is like the mountain is ready to collapse. If we even had a little earth tremor, it had come down. Mm. So it's just... I'm just so excited. What do they call it in the commercial world? I set a stretch target for myself, which was 41 men home, and no one hurt. And we got there. We did it.
Because the patience,
actually, we were all, yeah.
The
yeah.
patience and fortitude it would have taken, and particularly that last little bit when you knew that these men were almost safe, almost able to crawl through that tunnel and get themselves out. You spoke on Melbourne radio last week. Again, you were so confident. You said, we're going to get them out. We're going to get all 41. It's going to happen. That inner voice saying, oh, I don't know, Arnold. I don't know if you're going to make this happen. But the confidence, yeah. Where did that come from? I mean, you're an expert at this. You've done it before, but nothing like this.
No, there's nothing like this. I just, you know, my nana would say she felt it in her waters, right? I just had this feeling that we were going to do it, and I genuinely felt we were going to do it. And it was something infectious in me having that view, and it kind of infected everybody. And so our meetings would be so, okay, everything's just turned to shit. So okay, what are we going to do now? And so you'd have this group of people, we go, right, okay, well, are they all okay? Yeah, they're still okay. Okay, well, let's have a bit of a think. And while this was happening, the press would be screaming at us, when are you going to get them out? You know, why haven't you done this? Why haven't you done that? And we're all in our little room going, okay, let's all just count to five. Okay, good, take a breath. Now, what are we going to do? And between us, because it's not just this, we've also got another tunnel coming from the top of the mountain, boring down from the top. We've got another one coming from the side. We've got, like, we because we were so positive, and I think in a little bit, because I just felt that we could do it, even though I wasn't sure how, but I just felt that we could do it. And then we did. Like, we did. We actually did it. And it's so cool. And you know, and I'd say it, this is one of the things that drives me to this is it could have been my kids on the other side.
Yeah.
It could have been your kids. Yeah. And so these workers, they've done nothing wrong. If for those of you who haven't worked with the Indian construction workers, they just work really hard and they don't mean any harm. And they're just so, well, I don't know, everybody needs one. You know, they just get the job done there.
Arnold, take us through. We're looking at pictures of the workers embracing with what look like politicians or executive maybe of the company that involved there. But the looks on their faces and this moment, talk us through it, the moment when those embraces started to happen.
Yeah, so I don't know what images you've got, but right, I know where those cameras were because the cameras, only certain cameras are allowed in because I think even, well, everyone, I think everyone's a bit edgy, you know, you've got to say on its face, this could might have gone a bit grim. So I'm actually standing looking at that. If that's the angle, I think it is. If you look in the background, look for someone who looks like Father Christmas dressed in orange with a big smirk on their face. And that's me.
And
so what I'd been saying, and actually this was kind of sweet too, when I was asked when are they coming home, I would say always, and it used to drive the Indian press crazy, I'd say they were dancing for Diwali when they went in and they'll be able to sing Christmas carols at Christmas. That was my answer to when. And so what they've done, I've just seen a meme of me, which is really funny. They've got me as Father Christmas in the tunnel, which I think is really cool. But because and this became how everyone thought, they were all alive. So actually, why do we have to rush?
Yeah.
Right? So what we need is to be clever. We don't have to rush. We just have to be considered. We don't have to rush. They're all alive. They're all well. Let's not rush. Let's think about this. And then we go, okay, what's the downside? And that was about like, you know, 420 points of downside. Okay. And what's the good side? We don't have to rush. Okay. Let's think about this. So, So it's been a little bit of an epic for the world to go, how about just be nice?
Let's help each other.
You are so right, Arnold. Yep. Look, if you're just tuning in, it's 6:15 on this Wednesday morning and you're seeing Melbourne man Arnold Dix, a tunnelling expert, describe how he and others have freed these 41 miners down in the middle of the Himalayas after this avalanche. Arnold, how on earth did you end up here at this point in time? We say you're a tunnelling expert, but what's your background?
I'm that anonymous guy who really loves tunnels. And so when you, like, so I know so here's the thing. Go to a party and people say, what are you doing? I go, I really like tunnels. And they're like, oh god, so that's the end of that
guy.
So I'm that guy that no one even wants to talk to normally in a party, because I'll be like, oh yes, we've got new rock bolts now that are so much more secure, and everyone's like, yawn. So I'm the president, and this is going to show you there's more than me. I'm the president of the International Tunnelling and Underground Space Association. What a great name. Does that sound sexy or what? And we are... Oh, no, it gets better, but we are the peak advisory body to the United Nations on all things underground.
Oh, OK, and so that's why you got the call. They know who to call. You are somebody, Arnold. Boy, are you somebody.
And normally, and this is, I mean, I don't know how to say this, and this is going to be sound a bit odd, but normally no one wants to know anything about us because we are really dull, but we do great things. And normally when I get called to a disaster, it's extremely confidential because everyone's dead. Right? So you don't know me because I'm one of those anonymous people that just quietly goes around helping do stuff that no one wants to know about. So this is different because everyone was alive.
Yeah.
So that's why, right?
You're a lifesaver now. You're going to be the centre of attention at the next party you go to. You're not going to be the guy that no one wants to talk to. You're going to be the lifesaver, the guy that has this amazing story to tell. 41 lives you have saved, Arnold. That must feel
pretty special.
Helped save.
I've got to admit, I did start crying. And so, you know, in that scene where you've got all the people being greeted by the ministers and everyone, who are my friends, they're really cool guys too, so we're all friends. But I felt, and I know this might sound odd, but I actually felt that this wasn't anything to do with me and that I should step back for that moment because it's actually their children. These are India's children and they're really hard-working kids that they're bringing out. So I stepped back and I was actually sitting on the rocks behind the chairs where all the family were waiting to greet those people. And I was actually having a little sob. Anyway, one of the family turns to me and he's like, it's not in Hindi, so I didn't exactly know his words, but he's like pointing to me going, there's water coming out your eyes. I'm like, oh, sorry, sorry. And he must have thought I got something happy in tears. My eyes, maybe a bit of chili or something. They were happy tears.
Yeah.
But I do see it as a triumph. For just good people doing good stuff, and that's what we do here.
Yeah,
mate, well, we feel you, buddy. We do. We feel you, Arnold, and it's a special thing.
It is, and in India, you know what they're saying. The headlines are screaming, "A billion prayers have been answered." So it is a miracle. It is a wonderful thing you and your team have done. So take a bow, Arnold Dix.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Thank you for look. Thanks for talking to me, and I promise I'll be anonymous again. I'll sneak away.
Never.
But hey, everybody, when you get up in the morning and you get clean water and your toilet works and you get on the metro and your electricity comes on and your hydros and everything, that's what we do. That's what us underground people do.
Yeah.
And we love you all and we look after each other. Mm-hmm. And so if one of us is in trouble, we all help. And that's really what we did here. We all just got together. And the whole world, like I had something like 80 nations helping me out. I got a team of about 100,000 experts in my organisation. Like there's lots of nice people out there in the world. Don't believe what you hear. Yeah. Like there's lots of good ones, right?
So good.
That is a great message, and we will, and so will a lot of people because of you and your team. It is a great message. You are fantastic. Thank you so much for talking to us today.